90,000 Christians are martyred every year. Now that's according to the Center for the Study of Global Christianity. In other words, every 6 minutes, one person is killed for their faith. Either they are the most foolish individuals in the entire world because they are just following a silly book made by men, or they gave up their lives valiantly because this book that promised them eternal life and rewards is indeed from God. So what are they? Good morning, my friend. Welcome back to our series, Is the Bible Reliable? Because it came from God, not just a collection of human ideas. Our answer has actual consequences to our daily decisions. So to give an excellent response to this question, we will examine six important topics pictured like stairs to show God's attempt to reveal Himself to us through the Bible. Now we will begin from God's revelation to inspiration to canonicity until we reach sufficiency. Today we will continue inspiration or part two. Now, in part one, we defined and described what inspiration is. Then, we gave internal proofs that the Bible is indeed from God, not just written by men. We also started enumerating external proofs. But since we did not finish this in part one, hence part two. Now, if we can prove that the Bible is indeed from God, then our 90,000 brothers and sisters who died every year for Jesus did not die in vain. But if the Bible is not from God, then they died in vain. So, are you ready for part two? Before we go to our topic, Mosaic family would like to welcome you. Our goal is to attract foreigners of the gospel into a growing family of God. Now, we do this by inviting you, your friends, and your family to gather through house churches, digital or in person, and Sunday gatherings. Then we grow together in a community according to the Word of God. Then we equip you to go and share the gospel with your family and friends. Then we give birth to more churches and join God's growing family. Now, if you are from the US or Thailand or Philippines or Hong Kong, Canada, Israel, and the Middle East, our Mosaic family meets online throughout the week in these countries. Now, if you want to join, please leave me a message. Now, are you ready to continue part two? To recap, what are the remaining four out of six external proofs that the Bible is indeed from God? 2 Timothy 3:16 says, every scripture or all scripture is inspired by God. Now, inspired means God breathed or God is the source. So how can we prove it? This leads us to the third. Now, the third proof that the Bible comes from God is its indestructibility. Now, this proof is remarkable considering that the Bible went through four great oppositions like no other book. The first example is its indestructibility despite political opposition. It's a historical fact that many Roman emperors from the 1st to the 4th century hated the Bible so much that they killed Christians and burned Bibles the first chance they got using their political and military might. For instance, after ruthlessly destroying all the Bibles he could find, Emperor Diocletian in AD 303 erected a monument on top of what he thought was the last burning Bible with the words inscribed, extinct is the name of Christian. But after his death, 50 plus Bibles came out from hiding. And while his dust is long gone now, Guinness World Record says that the total number of Bibles sold is likely 5 billion and counting. Wow. Won't Emperor Diocletian be shocked if he comes back from the dead right now and observes that there are more Bibles than all the Roman books in his lifetime combined? Another illustration closer to our time. Communist leaders in Russia from 1922 to 1991 murdered up to 20 million Christians and burned all the Bibles they could get their hands on to eradicate the Bible from the face of the earth. But communism in Russia long passed, whereas the Bible thrives once again in the former USSR, being translated into multiple dialects. You cannot destroy the Bible. The second example is its indestructibility despite religious oppositions. For instance, most early popes were hostile when people read and translate the Bible. The worst came in 1199 when Pope Innocent III ordered the burning of all Bibles. Now, many thought that the Bible would disappear because the Pope, the most powerful person at that time, more powerful than many kings, ordered it. However, that Pope is gone, but the Bible keeps growing in number. Pope Innocent III was not the only religious authority that tried to eradicate the Bible. But you know what? It seems that no one can get rid of it. The third example is its indestructibility despite philosophical opposition. Now, what do I mean by this? Now, let me illustrate. This first story is a true story with some false information added, so I will dispel that incorrect information. The correct part of the story is that the famous French philosopher Voltaire, who disdained the Bible so much, was once quoted as predicting that in the 19th century, the Bible would be known only as a relic of antiquity. But after he died, the false part of the story is that the Geneva Bible Society purchased the same house he lived in and made it a depot for Bibles. That's not true. What is true, though, is that while the Geneva Bible Society or the Evangelical Society of Geneva did not actually buy Voltaire's house, Henri Tronchin, the president of the society, resided in Voltaire's house and used many of the rooms to store hundreds and hundreds of Bibles. And get this, these Bibles were printed on printing presses Voltaire once used in France. Today, Voltaire's works are seldom read by the general populace, whereas the number of people reading the Bible keeps increasing. Again, it seems no one can destroy the Bible. As someone said, the Bible is a book which has been refuted, demolished, overthrown, and exploded more times than any other book you ever heard of. But it's not just surviving, it's thriving. So how can you explain this? The fourth external proof that the Bible is not just from men but from God is its amazing unity. Now, what do I mean by this? Let me paint a picture that will surprise you or even shock some of you. Now, what's the chance of you finding a book written with 66 different parts from three different continents, Asia, Africa, and Europe, by 40 diverse people with assorted backgrounds living in different centuries? And yet, when you combine those 66 books, they all lead to one unified message. You see, it's next to impossible to connect the writings of some 40 random people with various occupations and come up with a unified, non-contradictory message. For example, Moses was an Egyptian prince. Joshua was a soldier. Samuel was a priest. David was a king. Esther was a queen. Ruth was a housewife. Job was a rich farmer. Amos was a poor farmer. John was a wealthy fisherman. Peter was a poor fisherman. And many more. Now, despite their diverse background and education, their writings were unified. Not only that, they came from different centuries. Now, the first book was written around 1500 BC. And then the last book was written around 96 AD. Not only that, they wrote from various locations, from three continents. Some books were written in the desert, from Mount Sinai, from an island, Egypt, Babylon, Rome, and many more. It's impossible, unless there is someone behind it. Another way to picture the Bible is to view it as a clock. Now, like a clock with 60 minutes leading towards the next hour, the Bible has 66 books, starting in Genesis, then Exodus, Leviticus, and all the way to Revelation. Each book building from the previous one to form one unified message. Now, this message is the message of salvation. Not just humans, but all of creation affected by sin. For example, in the first book, Genesis says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." And then in the last book, Revelation says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth." Did you see the progression towards one unified message of salvation? The fifth external proof that the Bible is inspired is its scientific accuracy. Yes, the Bible is not a science book. But if the Bible truly comes from God, then it must not contradict established scientific facts. Now, I emphasize the word established because, let's be honest, even the scientific community changes its position and its scientific findings every 15 years. But here are established scientific facts that the human authors of the Bible could not have known during their writings. Let me quickly share three. First, the prophet Isaiah in 700 BC wrote that the earth is spherical or round. But the prevailing thought before Isaiah's time until the 15th century is that the earth is flat. But now, science established that the earth is indeed spherical. So how could Isaiah know if not for someone telling him what to actually write? Secondly, Abraham in 2000 BC was told by God that the stars are innumerable in Genesis 15:5. But people for thousands of years, including the famous astronomer Ptolemy in AD 150, believed that there are only up to 1,200 stars. But now, with the invention of powerful telescopes, science confirmed that indeed the number of stars, good luck counting them. So how could Abraham know if not for someone telling him the truth? Third, the book of Job, probably the oldest book, mentioned in Job 26:7, that the earth is floating upon nothing or suspended in space. But again, people for thousands of years, even from other religious books, believed that the flat earth is sitting upon the back of either a gigantic elephant or a turtle. But now, science established that Job, who had no way of humanly knowing it, is correct all along. I have in my library a long list where established science confirms the Bible. Now, how about verses that contradict established science? I also have a list in my library. But I found out that these verses were taken out of context, or that interpreters were not sensitive to the literary genre of that particular verse, or that particular chapter, or book. For example, the expression four corners of the earth, or corners of the earth, is used at least 5 times in the Bible. Now, critics then cite these verses to show that the Bible believes in a flat earth, and therefore is unscientific. But the problem is, the Bible is using this phrase as an idiomatic expression, a figure of speech, to refer to the most distant parts of the earth or the entire world. Guys, all languages use idioms. For example, when we use the phrase, the best of both worlds, everybody knows that the speaker is not saying he believes in two separate earths. In short, established science confirms the Bible, and seeming contradictions are not contradictions at all, but a misunderstanding with the biblical context and genre. The sixth and last external proof is the Bible's life-changing power. Now, this proof is actually on the top of my list. You may not be familiar with the first 5 we have discussed, but you cannot ignore the life-transforming power of the Bible to others and to yourself. Now, just like the blind man who accepted the gospel, he declared confidently to the Pharisees, "One thing I do know, that though I was blind, now I see." This undeniable change is what we see until now. For instance, less than 200 years ago, Fiji was dubbed the cannibal capital of the world. The natives ate the first missionary that set foot on that island nation. Their leader, Chief Kakubau, once bragged he had eaten over 200 people. But after Chief Kakubau accepted Christ and started reading the Bible, he and the entire nation completely altered their lifestyle. That was in 1854. Now, in our present day, I have seen with my own 2 eyes how the Bible healed drug addicts, how sexual deviants were set free, how irresponsible parents were transformed, hardened criminals reformed. And I could tell you from the bottom of my heart that if not for the Bible, I would be in prison right now, or I would have been murdered, or probably have committed murder already. But you see, the Bible possesses a dynamic and transforming power. Why? Because it is truly God's Word. My friend, what happens when you view the Bible as from God? What's the result? The last part of 2 Timothy 3:16 answers that. Since all scripture is breathed out by God, then it is profitable or useful for teaching. Now, teaching is used to advance the knowledge of all. That means you'll grow higher. For reproof. Reproof is used here to expose error. For correction, now that word correction means to correct mistakes. It is the positive side of reproof. And for training in righteousness. Now that phrase means to train you to do right. Now this training makes you grounded. Wow, the Bible makes you well-rounded. And then 2 Timothy 3:17 continues, that the man of God may be complete or competent. It means to be able to meet all demands, equipped for every good work. My friend, do you need real comfort and strength during these uncertain times? The Bible will transform you. Do you need sure direction and guidance in your everyday decisions? The Bible will keep you from falling into mistakes and sins. Do you want to really know if there's hope in this life and the next life? Wow. This is God's gift to you. Devour it. Decide to read this every day, every night. But how do I know? How do I know this is complete? There might be more. How do I know I'm not missing anything? Wait for the next video.